Welcome to The Issue Is. I'm Elex Michaelson. This week, the issue is coronavirus. Dr. Mehmet Oz, one of the best-known doctors in the country, standing by to break down what California is doing differently than the rest of the country. And Bassem Youseff, one of the most popular comedians in the world, joins us to talk about how this has changed entertainment for good. The Issue Is starts right now.
Broadcasting across California, California's only statewide political show. You're watching The Issue Is.
Thanks for watching The Issue Is. I'm Elex Michaelson. With coronavirus dominating every aspect of our lives, we have one of the best-known doctors in the country to help break it down. Dr. Mehmet Oz hosts The Dr. Oz Show every day on most of the stations that also carry The Issue Is. He's with us from his home in New York. Dr. Oz, welcome back to The Issue Is, and thank you for all you are doing to keep us all informed.
You're very kind, Elex. I appreciate all the insights you're providing as well.
So let's begin, since this is California's political show, with the issue of how California is doing. We hear the president and some of his advisors actually showing that California is doing better than a lot of the other states. Why is that?
Well, a lot of you are probably thinking, my goodness, my government's not working. They're so slow. I got news for you. In this case, they were incredibly nimble. They were sage in their thoughts and decisive in their actions. So as an example, the city of Los Angeles actually shut down its schools even before the state government asked for it to happen. There was a decision made early on that you're going to be aggressive in social distancing. The decision more recently to advise people to wear masks if they're outside the house, which the rest of the country is following now. All these are examples of what Los Angeles did right. Now, there's another part to it as well. You're a little bit blessed. You don't have the best public transportation system underground in the world. So for that reason, a place like New York, right, which has a lot of public transportation needs and is quite good at it, congested people in the small spaces. And those ended up being really detrimental to our well-being because we could spread the virus rapidly when you're taking the A train uptown. In Los Angeles, you were spared that problem. You're also not as dense. Although it's a very populous city, second largest in the country, which everyone in Los Angeles should be proud of, you're not as densely populated as New York is. In fact, the second most densely populated city in the country is San Francisco, which also made some wise decisions, like Los Angeles, and for that reason was able to intervene a little earlier. But you know, I use this metaphor of the ship. You know, as you're heading towards that iceberg, a little bit of movement early on dramatically changes the likelihood you're going to hit it. We didn't move fast enough in New York, and we weren't too far off. I'd argue, you know, 5-6 days earlier would have been really, really sweet for us. We would have avoided the pain we're going through right now. And our peak time would not have only been earlier, but it would have been less high, less people going to the hospital, less intubated, less people dying. And that's the lesson of this virus. You don't have a chance to look back. You got to keep looking forward. So don't stare at the rearview mirror, but glance at it and realize the mistakes you made.
It's amazing how just a few days can make such a big difference on this issue. You brought up the issue of masks. Is it important to wear a mask while you're outside?
Well, it's most important to be socially distant, because if you're 6 feet from somebody, they're not going to be able to get their little droplets of spit in your nose as they talk to you. I mean, the word health, which is a good word normally, right? But health, when I make that end word, the TH, my tongue touches my lips and my teeth, and that actually jettisons spit from my mouth that can travel up to 6 feet. So wearing a mask is great if you can find them, but you can't and you shouldn't because we need them in the healthcare system. Until we get enough of them, you should, however, use cloth. Not as good as a regular mask, but a face covering of that nature can still work because we're learning more and more that the virus is not coming to us in these itty-bitty little packets that can slip through the cotton. It oftentimes travels in spit. And a cloth covering over your face would protect you against that. Plus, if you're sick, and remember, half the time the people with COVID-19 don't even know they're ill, if you're sick, it could dramatically change the ability for you to eject spit out of your mouth and infect others.
Let's also talk about another issue, which I think you have unique insight on, which is the mental health aspect of all of this. People are anxious. You know, 6.6 million people filing unemployment, seeing this saturated with this terrible news. What's your advice to people in terms of mental health in this moment?
Well, financial stress is the number one driver of poor health, in my opinion. And unfortunately, when you already have a risk to your health like the virus, and then you add financial issues on top of it, it gets that much worse. However, the bigger risk is we're isolated from each other. And that's obviously the intent of a shutdown, a shelter-in-place rule. But in China, when they looked at what happened to people in Wuhan, the biggest quarantine ever, 60 million people, they found that depression was present in about half the population. So we're supposed to be communal. We're supposed to be with each other, and we have trouble coping. So what's my recommendation? Well, it's to give hope. Now, how do you give real hope, true hope? It's to have purpose. Because when you have the ability to lean into a problem and you've got a vision for how you might fix it and you step into it, that gives you hope because you're controlling your destiny. And I think a lot of people are sitting at home now worried and appropriately anxious, but panicked as well, which doesn't help the situation much. And remember that in war, there are battlefield promotions, right? Commissions. Be a leader. Find out what you're able to do better than anybody else. Explore your own life and the opportunities that you may have squandered, but this may be your chance. This may define who you are. And then take that baton and run as fast as you can because people desperately need help, and you could be the person who provides it.
And I know also deep breathing and meditation has been helpful for you.
Well, I personally meditate every day. I don't know how people get through their day without meditation. And I don't do it in the morning, which a lot of folks do. I do it in the evening when I have the day is done. I need to relax and go to sleep. So I use it both as a sleep aid, but also a way of just processing what happened. But listen, if you don't want to get into a deep mystic meditation, I get it. Go to the bathroom, put the lid of the toilet down because you're not going potty, and just sit there quietly for 5 minutes. Just allow yourself to realize how cool it is to be alive. Even those 5 minutes will sort of settle you and has a profound impact on things like your blood pressure, but also the way the brain processes the world around you. And that connectivity and that creativity you get from that is more important than anything else you'll do because you can work hard or you can work smart or you can do both. I prefer the last.
Well, up next, we're going to talk more with Dr. Oz, specifically on how all this has impacted him, his show production, his family. But as we go to break, we want to have some music from the iHeartRadio show that they did on Fox this week. And Backstreet was back. Dr. Oz, I know you want it that way, right?
It's the best.
No question about that. This is where you get to dance, Dr. Oz. We'll be back with more right after this.
Millennials are taking it pretty seriously, at least from my anecdotal evidence. I don't have large statistics on this, but
Dr. Oz's kids debate on his show. Dr. Oz has been taping from home after one of his employees tested positive for coronavirus. Dr. Oz back with us now. First off, how is that employee of yours doing?
He's doing very well. He's a good friend, actually. So we were talking a lot anyway, but he's a real stud, I'll tell you why. Because as soon as he noticed he had a subtle little cough, he noticed it coming into work. He immediately left. He didn't hang out for the day. He didn't, pass go, collect $200 and infect half the team. He just took off. And because of that, he was able to avoid contaminating people because we had an office that, although we were already socially distancing and we were doing shows on it, so everyone knew the rules, he picked up on the clue early enough to get out of Dodge and thus spared out my team.
And he's an editor on your team, right? And now you've been working from home. Talk about how your family has all been pitching in on this and how this has maybe changed your family dynamic.
Well, I'll give you a little background here. My show is in over 100 countries. So one of those countries is China. So in January, I actually found myself making content about coronavirus before anyone here was really thinking about it. And I frankly never imagined it would devastate us the way it has. I just thought there was a problem in China. If they'd gotten it earlier, it would have been okay. We won't make that mistake. Humbleness would have gone a long way. But my team said, just in case, let's build a studio in your basement, which I thought was overkill. I thought, those prepper shows where they're storing things for all eternity in their basement? That's what I felt was going on. So they built this space around me. And when we finally knew we had to leave, we basically had a day to get out of town. So there wasn't a lot of time, which is why so many shows ended up getting shut down, at least for a while, because you can't move a show that quickly. We thankfully had a lot of the infrastructure already built. The problem is I can't let people in here because then you're not socially distancing yourself if folks are traveling back and forth and we're sort of on lockdown. So who do I turn to? The kids, because they were on lockdown too. So I've got four of them. And the oldest one, Daphne, who's got four grandchildren, so I've got four grandkids. She helps because she runs the quarantine kitchen. She's a chef, Daphne.
Right.
She does MasterChef Junior with Gordon Ramsay.
Right.
She does the dish on my show. She hosted the Chew. So she makes all the meals, and my grandkids do all the craft table stuff. So they'll help out in making, showing people how to make masks that are from bandanas and things like that, and it sort of adds a little flavor to it. My son, who's goes to Harvard, but they closed the school down, so he does tech support. He's in here all hours, making sure the cameras are working and, you know, doing the switches. My wife does the prompter and hair and makeup, which I can't do this. And I can't have any, my hair hasn't been cut in a while for a reason. Right. But all of us are living this new life, so don't think you're alone out there. Every single person you watch on television, every person you're talking to, an Instagram story, is all the same basic story. We're just making do with what we got.
How grateful are you that you procreated a lot? You created.
I'm thanking my wife every day. I really, because I'm as a surgeon, I wasn't home that much.
Right.
So I took opportunities when they arose.
And just to wrap things up really quick, because this is fun. We saw this on one of the other shows I've done with you. You actually are near a basketball court in your house, and then you have beer pong cups from your kids as well, right?
So I don't have any cups down here, so I took the beer pong cup, but there's water, not beer, in there. And my biggest nervous moment is when I'm in a soundproofed space pretty much, but they play basketball because one side of the studio is just a basketball net. So they bang the ball in there, so I have to yell out in interviews once in a while, keep it down, even though it is a basketball court.
Strange new world in so many ways. Cheers to you, Dr. Oz. And as I've said, one day my dream is to play basketball and beer pong with you at your house.
Well, you've got the height and the skill, so I'm sure it'll be fun.
All right.
Bye, Alex.
As we go to break, more music from this week's iHeartRadio show on Fox. This is from the best-selling female artist of all time, Mariah Carey.
You'll always be a part of me.
I know you're all dancing at home as well. She makes homemade look good. I think she got a little help with the hair and makeup there. Who knows? More of the issue is right after this.
Bassem Youseff is known as Egypt's Jon Stewart.
30 million viewers for his weekly program.
40% of the entire population is watching.
It's someone who's saying things that are similar to what we're saying to each other, things that are not usually on TV.
Bassem Youseff has been called the Jon Stewart of the Middle East. He was the most popular comedian in all of Egypt. He was arrested after insulting the Egyptian leader. Jon Stewart made a movie about him. Now he's living here in California. He's a successful stand-up comedian doing 1,000 different things at once. Bassem was originally booked on this show to talk about his comedy tour, but like so many other things, that's now on hold. Bassem now joins us via Zoom to talk about the future of entertainment. Bassem, welcome to The Issue Is.
Hi, guys. Thank you so much for having me.
You know, you posted this picture that was really something of your birthday, which was basically you by yourself holding a balloon with a K, which I thought was so fitting to go from these massive comedy shows to go to that moment. How are you holding up and how has your life changed?
Well, it's kind of like I'm starting to discover my apartment. I have like daily expeditions, and every day there's like a new corner that I go and explore. Also, I'm getting to know my kids. My kids are getting to know me. I think they're realizing that there's a father, and that they don't just like come out from their. They're kind of like at the beginning they were kind of like wondering who's that guy who's hanging around for longer than he should be. I think I kind of like hang around like enough to think that I'm like the delivery guy that occasionally sleeps over. But I think now they're realizing that I'm actually a part of their life, whether they like it or not.
Yeah. Is that a good thing or a bad thing?
It's good. It's good. I have a 2.5 years old who's basically a pet, because in that age, they have the same properties of pets. You know, they like to go outside. They poop everywhere, and they eat from your plate, and they jump on your keyboard, and they're very clingy. So he's kind of like he's a poodle basically. And Nadia, that's Adam. Nadia is older. She's 8. She's handling it quite well.
Well, we can't stop you from working. You've been going online. You have tens of millions of followers in social media. You've been trying to break down some of these conspiracy theories, especially in the Middle East. What are some of the worst conspiracy theories about the coronavirus that you've seen out there?
Well, so first, it started as a Facebook post. So basically, one of the first ones is that this is no virus. It's actually sarin gas. Mm. And it is... And I think it's written in a way that they give, that they would kind of like mention certain real events, but they would kind of mix it up with unreal stuff. People are so scared and so afraid, and they're panicking all the time, and they need anything to hold on to.
Mm-hmm. And it's interesting because you come from a perspective of not only being a comedian star, you're also a doctor who has that in your previous life as well. What do you make of this from a medical perspective, this moment in history?
The human history is full of famines and plagues and natural disasters. I mean, just in the last 100 years, we had five or six plagues, pandemics. We had the Spanish flu that took out 50 million people. 50 million people died from between 1917 and 1920.
Your comedy, in terms of on the road, has stopped. You know, the entertainment industry, one of the biggest industries in all of California, is basically shut down. What do you make of this moment in pop culture and how it will change pop culture and entertainment going forward?
If someone who's unemployed will not go and pay a ticket to go to see a comedy show, they will try to save for rent or for food, right? That's what happens. So I think that will affect us big time. It's not just the comedians, right? We go as a comedian, we go to a comedy club, right? That comedy club is now shut down. And all of the staff, the waiters, the managers, all of those people are now are not having a job.
And what do you make of, as a former late night comedian yourself, who had the biggest show in Egypt, what do you make of the way that the late night guys are handling this, doing the shows from home, doing shows essentially via Zoom or FaceTime? What do you make of that?
Well, I think that, so sorry, there's someone who's, come on, sorry.
Is that the poodle?
Another poodle. Why do they have to be so noisy? Just have to be noisy. Why can't they just like walk as monks?
Yeah.
Like have a vow of silence.
It's the new world. It's everybody is a can relate to that moment right now.
Yeah. 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 I love kids. So loving kids.
Yeah.
Anyway, so all right. So to answer your question, I think what the late night show hosts are doing is quite courageous, is quite, admirable. It's just, first of all, they are keeping the people behind the camera working. They're still maintaining their jobs, which is very important. Because you cannot afford to lose the amount of talent that go into unemployment and bad habits. They're keeping people entertained. They're keeping people sane. As a performer, it's so hard to do this without the energy of the studio and people cheering and clapping and laughing along with you.
And last question. I mean, you're such an intellectual in the way you process things. How do you think this is going to change the way that we interact with each other going forward?
I have a hope and a fear. My hope is this can make people realize that our planet that we're dealing with is not something to mess up with. Now, my fear is that we as humans has very, very, very short memory. We have a very short memory, and we come up from disasters, and after a while, we forget about everything, and we go back to the things that we do. Whoever said history repeats itself was a genius, because it does.
Let's hope that doesn't happen. Bassem Youseff,
we're
glad. One of the things we got to do with this is get to know you a little bit better. So we appreciate you taking the time. Thank you so much.
And I hope next time it's going to be in person.
I hope so, too. Can't wait for that to happen. Our thanks
to
Bassem Youseff. Up next, my exchange with Governor Gavin Newsom from this week. As we go to break, one of my favorite moments from this week, James Corden, speaking of late night hosts, invited the stars of the Broadway hit Dear Evan Hansen to remotely film the song You Will Be Found. Here's a clip. We'll be right back after this.
You will be found.
Thank you for being our first guest on our first show.
Honored to be here. Thanks for having me.
All right, let's talk about
In May of 2018,
right now,
Gavin Newsom was the first guest on the first episode of The Issue Is. Our show started as a Friday night local politics show in Los Angeles. This is episode number 100. We're now a statewide show airing in all different time slots all over the state. It's amazing to think how different the world is from even a few weeks ago, much less May 2018. Once again this week, I spoke with now Governor Gavin Newsom after he announced that 25,000 California medical professionals stepped up to volunteer their services.
This has got to be the biggest leadership test of your life. I'm wondering, how are you doing right now? And also, to that point, to see the extraordinary, as you mentioned, 25,000 Californians coming forward and all the different Californians coming and all different businesses.
I'm inspired. You want to ask how I'm doing? I'm inspired. I've never been more damn inspired in my life. To see that number, just 25,000 yesterday alone of professionals that are willing to come out of retirement to put their lives back on the line, that makes me sleep well at night. And so thanks for asking. No one asked that question. I appreciate it. But no, when you have the privilege that I do of representing the state, that will enliven your senses and distill a sense of well-being that makes me feel very, very good about this moment.
I'm damn inspired as well. Since that exchange, by the way, three times that number have stepped up to help. So many Californians we're now leaning on. And speaking of leaning on, we lost a giant in the world of music this week, Bill Withers.
Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend.
This song, like so many of his songs, Ain't No Sunshine, Use Me, Just the Two of Us, seemed tailor-made for this strange moment in time. As we close this week, we want to pay tribute to the heroes among us, who have all left us damn inspired. The medical workers, the first responders, the grocery workers, government officials, journalists, and others who continue to risk their own lives to help save ours. Thank you all for your sacrifice. We're so lucky to be able to lean on you. I'm Elex Michaelson. Thanks for watching The Issue Is.
Somebody to lead.